Well, good evening. If you'll stand with us this evening, we're going to sing I'll Fly Away.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Let's do another verse.
Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Shall we gather at the river where bright angel feet have trod? Crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. On the margin of the river, washing up its silver spray, we will walk and worship ever all the happy golden day. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river that flows by the throne of God. Soon we'll reach the shining river, soon our pilgrimage will cease, soon our happy hearts will quiver with the melody of peace. Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river by the throne of God.
Amen. Let's pray for this offering. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us this blessing, this opportunity to come here tonight and to participate in worship and to hear your word being taught. God, I pray that you would prepare each and every heart, God. We pray that you would take this offering that we're about to receive, that you would use it for your honor and for your glory. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. If you'll stand with us again this evening, we're going to sing A New Name in Glory.
I was once a sinner, but I came, pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word. Oh, there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam.
On the second,
I was humbly kneeling at the cross, fearing not but God's angry frown. When the heavens opened and I saw that my name was written down, oh, there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh, yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh, yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam.
On the last,
in the book 'tis written, save by grace, oh, the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know by the blood I am made whole. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a sinner has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam.
Amen. You may be seated.
Yesterday's battles are today's victory.
If you are weary from the burdens you bear, so tired of struggling and getting stand in your place. When it is over, you'll once again say,
yesterday's trials give me strength for today, and serves to yesterday's battles
Praise the Lord. It's good to see everyone here this evening. I walked in and I could tell something was not right with the air again. And so Brother John told us we have a compressor that's out. So praise the Lord, though. It's cool enough to bear and we can worship the Lord. And also got baptism tonight. Excited about that. So looking forward to it. If you got your Bibles, turn to 2 Timothy chapter 4, if you will. We're going to continue on. Just another quick reminder for you ladies. If you haven't signed up for our ladies' retreat, really want to encourage you to do that tonight. I need to finish all the preparations and purchasing and stuff like that. So really encourage you to come and be here. It's not just for the young. It's not just for the old. It's for everyone. And so I want to encourage you to be here, and don't miss that time of fellowship, but also encouragement. It's Friday evening and Saturday morning. You can stay the night here, or you can live close by. You can go home Friday night after the fellowship and come back Saturday morning. But I encourage you to do that tonight. It's the last night to register. So last week, the notes that we looked at was, number one, in light of mounting difficulties, determined to stay strong and stay faithful to the work that we exist for. Note two, let's strive to see the value by faith of fighting the good fight and finishing our course as we anticipate our Savior's return. And this week, we're going to look at the value of a reliable team. And all through Paul's letters, he uses analogies of athletic contest and of military tactics and strategy and again, mindset. But he also describes throughout his letters the body of Christ just like that, as a body, as the human body. Aside from the direct commands to have the mind of Christ, to be like-minded, to be of one accord, to have the same love, aside from all that, there are very clear implications that the only way we are truly going to be effective in this world for the kingdom of God is when we're working in that capacity, in complete unity. As a body works together, as a team works together, as a military unit works together, all those things are very clear, are clearly spelled out in Scripture, that that's the way that we are going to be effective for the kingdom of God. How many people know what it's like to have a foot or a hand go to sleep on them? I know very well. Sometimes I go to sleep and I wake up in the middle of the night and I guess I fall asleep with my arms under my pillow and one of my arms, I guess, doesn't like it more than the other one. And so I'll sometimes wake up in the middle of the night and I can tell it's completely asleep. Like no movement, no use, no function at all. And it kind of scares me because I'm thinking, I can't feel a thing. I could roll on it and snap it in half and not even know. Because I'll be sitting there and I'll be smacking it. I can't feel a thing. And sometimes I'll roll over and I'll have my arm and just like keep it up and put it in place until it goes, comes back to awake. And but anyways, it made me think about this. Having a member, a part of our body that isn't functioning the way it's supposed to function, that's not useful, truly hinders the whole body. Because again, I'm afraid to get up. I'm afraid to do anything, move any other way, because I don't want to injure the arm. I have no idea where it's at and what it's doing, really, unless I'm holding on to it. I think the same is true for sickness and disease. When we look at our body, look at if something becomes diseased or sick, our lungs, our bronchial tubes, whatever. It hinders and affects the whole body. You can't run, you can't go, you can't do the things that you normally can do when you're fully functioning and all parts are working together. Again, this shows us, I believe, the value of reliability. To be able to just get up and go, to just be able to do the way that we're designed to do. is so vital, is so important. There's nothing, I think, more frustrating than when you want to do something, but you can't, because either your arm's asleep or a limb's asleep, or something's hurt, something's diseased. And so again, it's so important to see not only that in our individual lives, but our part in the body of Christ, our part as a team member in this specific local body, but in the kingdom of God. And so I want to pray tonight and get into the scripture and look at, again, the value of a reliable team. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this time again. Thank you for the music. Thank you so much for just the blessing of being able to open your word and turn to you, God, and receive from you what you have for us. So in the middle of this week, God, we've already been so blessed by Sunday service and Monday, just being thankful and grateful for our freedom, remembering all the men and women who have gone before us and preserved freedom, paid the ultimate price, that are still serving to preserve our freedom. Lord, again, and ultimately, thanking you for our liberty, specifically of our spiritual liberty. God, it's been a blessed week, but tonight we ask that you would encourage us, you would strengthen us, you give to us what we need, and help us take from tonight what's so important and may it affect our lives for your kingdom. We'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. That's precious. That's why I didn't say anything. That's so cute. Oh, that's awesome. I didn't want to scare her. That's why I didn't say anything. I was going to say hi. Yeah, no, you're fine. If you have your Bibles in 2 Timothy chapter 4, if you look at verse 9, remember, Paul's writing to Timothy, and he says this, "Do thy diligence to come shortly unto me. For Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica, Crescens to Galatia, Titus unto Dalmatia." Now remember, again, he's writing this to Timothy, his son in the ministry, his beloved, if you will, in the ministry. And the first statement to him here is, do your very best to come to me. With everything in your power, please come and see me. Why the question comes to mind, why would someone like the Apostle Paul, so strong, so used of God, why would he be so desperate for someone like Timothy to come and see him? Why is this so important? Look, do your very best to come and see me. Well, first of all, I believe he knew his time of departure was at hand. He knew he was about to die. He was about to go be with the Lord. And so I think that was important for him to see Timothy one last time. But secondly, I want to be reminded of the yoke that Paul and Timothy had, to be reminded of that unity, that bond that they had in the ministry work. And in Philippians chapter 2, Paul's talking to the Philippian believers, and he tells them, I'm going to send Timothy to you because of this. Because I have no man, in verse 20, like-minded, who will naturally care for your state. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. But you know the proof of him, that as a son with the Father, he hath served me in the gospel. Again, Timothy had shown that he was on the same exact page as the Apostle Paul, striving for the same exact things that the Apostle Paul was striving for. The Apostle Paul was clearly serving the Lord, and he knew that this man, this young man, Timothy, was there with him through thick and thin. He was there serving him in the gospel, serving with him in the gospel. Now this type of heart, this type of devotion that we see here, this commitment, this faithfulness, this reliability, was a refreshment, I believe, to the apostle. It was a refreshment to a man who had been through so much, who had given his life for the cause of the gospel. Timothy was a refreshment to him. And I believe in contrast to what he had experienced with others who were a part of the team before. Those team members that were on board and going forward, and then all of a sudden something pulled them away. Something caused them to leave. Something caused them to stop. Something pulled them back from their commitment, their dedication, and from being a reliable team member. Now, sometimes in some of the instances that we saw, he mentioned a couple of the other men were going to a different place, but they didn't say that it was because they loved this present world. They maybe had a calling to that place. And sometimes that's what I believe Paul experienced. But that's a difficult thing to experience as well. To have a calling when you got a team together and someone is pulled away to do part of the work of God, that's a difficult thing to go through. Paul had experienced it. But sometimes it was circumstance. Maybe family members or other things came up in it and it pulled them away from the team. Geography, they moved. Again, different things pulling people away. You know, we've experienced that as a church in the last few years with a few different families. And it's difficult. It's hard to go through. But again, it was for the advancement of the gospel. And again, Paul knew that, but it didn't make it any easier. But this abandonment, this abandonment for the sake of sin, this abandonment for the sake of self and selfishness or flesh, or as Paul put it, for the love of this present world, to abandon what God was doing and what God had in store, to say, you know what, I'm not going to give as much. I'm not going to be a part. I'm going to go back to Thessalonica like Demas did. It's hard to deal with. That type of departure is hard to deal with. In our text, this is the third reason that Paul wanted Timothy to come, I believe. He's in verse 10. For Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica. It's hard to deal with that. Once again, the trials, the loss, sacrifice were too much for one of the team members there. So because of the love of the world, more than their love for God and His work, Demas left the apostle, left the team, and I would say in the midnight hour, if you will, because again, his departure was at hand. And I want to point this out. There's nothing more important. There's no work more important than the kingdom work. And so when Paul is writing to Timothy and he's explaining, listen, I need you to come to me because you don't realize the condition that I'm in. I know that I've fought the fight. I've kept the faith. I've finished my course. All those things are true. But the reality is everybody pretty much has left. We need, I need, I believe we all need committed, devoted, trustworthy, and reliable. That spirit, we all need that. Same heart, same love, same mind. We all have to have that. Again, the kingdom work is too important not to have that. And Paul had this with Timothy. He says, listen, I need you to come to me. These people have left. And only in verse 11, Luke is with me. Luke, the physician, was the only one that was left. Again, we could go back through and we can name all the people that Paul wrote to the Colossians, to the Philippians, all the different people that had come and gone and had been a part of the missionary team along the way, from the beginning, from the middle. All along the way, there were people that were there serving with that same heart, same mind. And now he has one person left, Luke. Now, somebody might say, well, is Luke not good enough? I mean, why was he asking for Timothy to come? Well, you could debate over that. Well, Luke was just there to do a job, to look after him if he was a physician, to document what was going on. All kinds of different opinions about that. He says, only Luke is with him. But look at that next statement he says. Take Mark and bring him with thee, for he's profitable to me for the ministry. He goes on and says, in Tychicus, have I sent to Ephesus the cloak that I left at Troas with Carpus. When thou comest, bring with thee, and the books, but especially the parchments. So he says, listen, I have Luke with me. I need you here with me. Tychicus has gone. Nobody's left except for Luke. But bring John Mark with you too. Bring John Mark when you come. Bring that cloak that I left. Bring the books that you have, but especially the parchments, especially those things. And again, there's speculation, debate on what this was. Most people thought it was the word of God that was special to him, of course. But I want to say this about this section of Scripture, because I believe in our lives and specifically in ministry, because that's what our lives on this earth are for, is to serve the Lord, ministry. We have earthly jobs to help pay for the food and the bills, but we're all here to serve the Lord. Just like I said Sunday, the church exists for God's mission. And so that's why we exist on this earth, is to accomplish His work. Not ours, not what the world says is important, but to accomplish God's work. So in our lives and in our ministry, I believe there's typically two types of co-laborers that we have as we're serving God. There's two types of people, I believe, that again, in the Lord's work, in the kingdom work, that exist in our lives. The first group are those who add. Those who add to us and add to the work. And then I believe there are those that subtract. Those that take away. Someone once said that there are people in our lives who drain us. And others who fill us. At one point in ministry, early in the missionary journeys of Paul, the first missionary journey, John Mark was one who drained the Apostle Paul, who subtracted, who took away from the ministry, from the work of the ministry, from the team, from what God was doing with that ministry team. Early on, he was one of those who subtracted by subtracting himself. By saying, you know what, it's not important for me to be a part of this team anymore. I've got other business, I've got important business, or whatever the case may be. This is too hard for me to continue. I'm going back to Jerusalem. Whatever the reason was, at that point in ministry, John Mark was one who drained and subtracted himself from the Apostle Paul and from the ministry. And that lack of commitment, that lack of reliability, that lack of fortitude or strength, if you will, led the Apostle Paul and Barnabas to having this sharp disagreement whenever it came time for the second missionary journey. The Bible says that there was a sharp contention. They had this strong disagreement. Paul says, listen, I'm not taking him. Because when they said, hey, let's go back and visit the churches that we've established along the way. And Barnabas says, great, I'll go get John Mark. Paul says, no, we're not taking him. Barnabas says, yes, we are. And again, that began the strong disagreement. Because Paul was looking at the fact that he wasn't reliable, that he wasn't committed, that he wasn't on board, that he wasn't giving himself 100%. Something took him away back to Jerusalem. Whenever the time was necessary, whenever the ministry and the work was hard, he subtracted himself. So they departed ways. I want to read that there in Acts chapter 15. It says, in some days after Paul said to Barnabas, this is what I said a while ago, let us go again and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord, and see how they do. And Barnabas determined to take with them John, whose surname was Mark. But Paul thought not good to take him with them, who departed from them from Pamphylia, and went not with them to the work. To the work. And the contention was so sharp between them that they departed asunder from one another. And so Barnabas took Mark and sailed unto Cyprus, and Paul chose Silas, and departed, being recommended by the brethren unto the grace of God. And he went through Syria and Cilicia, confirming the churches. Now, at that point, Paul, he couldn't have confidence in John Mark. He couldn't say, he's helpful in the ministry. He's beneficial to me in the ministry. At that point, when they were going back on the second missionary journey, he was looking at John Mark's deserting of the work. Again, not being reliable. However, by the time his life and his ministry were coming to an end, John Mark had evidently showed himself as a faithful, trustworthy, reliable, and profitable part of the ministry. So much so that Paul tells Timothy, who Paul has to see, bring John Mark too. Bring him with you because he is profitable for me for the ministry. And I believe this tells us a couple things. Number one, I believe it tells us that it ain't over until it's over. In your life, in ministry, it's not over. If you, like John Mark, maybe you haven't been as reliable as you know you should be. Maybe you haven't been as trustworthy or strong, having that fortitude. Maybe you haven't had that commitment. Maybe you haven't been profitable. Maybe you haven't been one that has been adding to the ministry. You can start tonight. And you can finish like John Mark. Someone who the Apostle Paul says, you know what? Bring him because he's a blessing to the ministry. He's a blessing to me. Bring him. But the second thing I think it tells us is you never know how your life will be a prophet or a blessing to someone. You never know. To the ministry, to a ministry, to the pastor, to the leadership, to the church as a whole, to the kingdom of God as a whole. Unless you're willing to invest yourself 100%, you won't know. And that's what was missing with John Mark before. I believe as they took off, maybe he had naive ambition. Maybe he was excited about the ministry. But once they got there and it started to get difficult, or whatever the situation was, he began to say, I don't know that I can go on. And at some point, he made a decision to say, I'm going back there and I'm not continuing on to the work. Because if it gets harder, I can't do it. Now, we see that Barnabas took John Mark, and they continued on in a journey. They went back to Cyprus. Maybe Barnabas took some time ministering and teaching John Mark about commitment, about reliability, about being strong in the Lord and not having a spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. And maybe he taught John Mark all those things. And Paul kept hearing reports. And Paul, every time they'd come back, he'd see John Mark serving and being faithful. Evidently, it made enough impact for him to say, bring him with me. See, me, you, none of us, as the children of God, as workers in God's kingdom, we cannot have part of ourselves in. We cannot be partially committed to the work of God. You and I have to be 100% in. We have to be 100% in unity, striving for the same exact thing. So the question tonight, every single one of us has to ask ourselves is am I there? Am I there? Am I at 100% commitment, 100% investment into the kingdom of God, striving for God's glory, striving to accomplish his mission? This simple mention of Luke, I think, carries with it much more than just the words, only Luke is with me. So again, Luke, along with Demas, was with Paul even in the first imprisonment. He mentioned that. He mentions that in a couple of his letters while he was in that first Roman imprisonment. He talks about Luke and Demas with him. But Demas is gone now. Others sent to the work of ministry. But here's something important. Luke remained. Luke remained. He stayed. What a testimony. He remained through all of it. When others had left, when others were gone, when it was too hard for others, Luke was the one that was steadfast and reliable. Not just sitting. He wasn't just sitting, but he was serving. He was there and he was serving. Riding, ministering, helping, suffering along with Paul, laboring in unity to see the gospel work continue. And that brings us to note number one tonight. Faithfulness, trust, and reliability are essentials if we're going to see the eternal work of God continue in and through our lives. Those are the things, if we're going to see the eternal work of God, if we're going to be in, we all have got to be on the same page in unity. If we're going to see it continue in and through our lives, we have to be faithful. We have to have trust. We have to be reliable. But I believe on the other side of faithfulness and unfaithfulness, those two, the issues of reliability and unreliability, on the other side of that, I believe, is something that we've got to remember, is something we've got to factor in into our commitment, into our investment, and that's attack. Those who are seeking to destroy the work of God and the workers of God, that's a part of the equation as well. So that's the reason why it's so important for you and I to be together 100%, 100% committed, 100% reliable, 100% giving ourselves to the work of God, because when we're not reliable, we're not faithful, we're not trustworthy, we don't have those things, that hinders the work, and it helps those who are also attacking the work. That's part of the factor that's so hard to deal with, honestly, for me. Now, maybe it's not the deliberate thought, maybe it's not the deliberate action, but I believe through actions, through attitudes, and through speech, many people do much harm to not only ministers, but to ministries and to churches, the kingdom of God. There's not a lot known about this man that we're going to look at. Could be the same person that's mentioned in Acts chapter 19, Alexander. who was a Jew, tried to speak up when the frenzied Ephesian crowd wanted an answer. Their idol-making business was in jeopardy, and Alexander gets thrown to the front. They find out he's a Jew, and they move on and start chanting, you know, Diana is great or whatever. But Paul mentioning him to Timothy, who again was a minister there in Ephesus, could lead us to believe it's that same Alexander. But there's no 100% concrete evidence of that. This could be the man that Paul mentioned in 1 Timothy in his first letter, who he delivered to Satan along with Hymenaeus to learn not to blaspheme the name of the Lord. Could be that Alexander. Nevertheless, this man had caused problems, not just in ministry, but personally to Paul. He'd caused issues. Look in verse 14. Alexander, the coppersmith, did me much evil, and the Lord reward him according to his works. And then he goes on and says, of whom be thou ware also, for he hath greatly withstood our words. Paul makes it very clear. It's not only unprofitable to hold a grudge, but it's useless. This man that had done personal injury to him, that he was warning Timothy about, listen, he can damage you, he can hurt you, he can do those things to you, but listen, I'm telling you about him to warn you about him. But I know that God is the judge. He's the judge, he's the avenger of the just. He is going to hold this man accountable for what he's done. That's the first thing I believe Paul had in telling Timothy this. But the second thing is this, focusing on these people that are attacking the work of God, focusing on their antics, distract from the work of the kingdom. When we look at people who are, however way they're doing it now, on Facebook or in your personal life, at your job, whatever, saying, you know, why do you do this? Why do you go there? Maybe it's your family. Unfortunately, some people deal with it inside their own home. Attacking the work, attacking the ministers. But again, Paul not only faced this type of attack, not only was dealing with this, there were times that he stood alone. And it was the Lord by his side, just the Lord. And what's encouraging for me is that was enough for Paul. And again, in your life, maybe it's not... you know, one thing, maybe it's another. And you say, I feel like I'm alone in this struggle. I feel like I want to be committed. I want to do this. I want to do that. But I feel like this attack is keeping me held back. Again, for the Apostle Paul, he continued the work, knowing it was right to continue in the work, even if no one was there by his side, even if it was God only by his side. He knew he had to continue. In our text, verse 16, first answer, no one stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear. And I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion, and the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work, and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, of whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. So not only is it difficult to continue the work of God, to really see the work of God flourish, because there are those that aren't reliable, those who aren't committed. But the other side is, as we've seen, there are those who are attacking. My prayer is that none of that is in our church. There's not a lack of progress in the kingdom of God through this church, because there's unreliability or there's unfaithfulness. There's lack of commitment. Or I pray that there's never any internal attack, that we would be the cause of someone not giving their all or not being able to give their all. Whether it be through words or actions or attitude. You know, I've said this before, Satan sometimes just can stand back and not really mess with a whole lot, because we're good at getting ourselves off track. That's right. We're good at in our flesh looking at our brother and sister and looking at this and talking and tearing them down or saying things to attack. And again, it may not be with words, maybe it's with actions. Satan says, man, I can take a step back, I can take a little break, because they're doing good enough for me. Which is sad. But then I think also he stands back and he sees the damage that's done or the lack of progress that goes on, because there's those who say they're committed, but they aren't committed. There are those that should be reliable, that should be those that are adding to and enhancing and helping progress. There should be every member of the body of Christ doing that, but there are some that are subtracting. There's some that aren't committed all the way. There's some that, because of that, they aren't reliable. And so the work of the ministry, as difficult as it may be, personally for people, it's hindered. It doesn't go on. And so Satan, I believe, stands back and does the same thing as with attacks. Man, as long as they're halfway committed, I'm okay with that. I can stir up the stuff every now and then and cause some of those that are halfway committed to be a quarter committed or not committed at all. I can maybe go in there and see those that are 100% committed and really try to get them off track. Again, Paul's in this place, having faced all these things, having faced abandonment, having faced attack, personal attack. His ministry has been attacked. And he says, you know what? I pray that these things aren't laid to those who've forsaken, those who haven't been reliable. I pray that it's not laid to their charge. And about that guy who's been personally attacking to me, God's going to judge him. But Timothy, beware of him, because he can do you some damage. But through it all, the mindset he had, the reality he experienced, is that the Lord was by his side. And I believe that's the mindset that we all need to have at this end of the age. I believe that we should all strive to work together as a team, together for the same purpose, knowing the Lord is by our side to accomplish his purpose, not to get weary in well-doing, but to continue on. Again, the mission that we exist for. When we find that there's not very many people around us running that race as hard as we're running, there's not very many people as reliable as we would hope there would be, when there's attacks coming at us, trying to get us to stop, what do? We continue. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 58, I love it. I've said it before, my life verse. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Why? Because as much as you know, as your labor is not in vain in the Lord. You know that what you're doing for God, for the right reason, isn't for nothing. So continue. Be steadfast. Don't waver. Don't move. Continue right on. And then what we looked at Sunday in Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Again, don't if you get wearied and begin to faint in your mind, think about Jesus Christ, who endured such contradictions of sinners against himself. Continue on. Note number two tonight as the musicians come. No matter who or what comes against us, we must faithfully press on with the Lord by our side, knowing that he will bring us safely into his kingdom and reward us for faithfulness. And that's the word I want to resonate. Faithfulness. In all things. Timothy was the one Paul called for because he was faithful and reliable. He added to the apostle. He added to the ministry. And so he said, I need you to come to me. The time of my departure is at hand. I've run my race. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith. But I need you to come to me. You add something to me. You're a blessing to me. You're a blessing to the ministry. Bring John Mark too, because he's a blessing as well. Everyone's left me. I'm sitting here in this prison, and Luke is the only one part of the team. He's reliable. He's been here. He's been steadfast. And again, I pray that is the characteristics of our lives. Things are going to get tough. Things are going to get harder. Things are going to come against us. Again, outside of our home, inside of our home, but remain. Be like Luke, remain. Be like Timothy, add to, enhance, be committed, be reliable. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this time. Thank you for your word. God, you know what my prayer has been all along, getting ready for this message. God, I want this to be me. Lord, I want to be reliable. I want to be committed. I want to be 100% committed. I want to be someone who you use that's adding and enhancing your kingdom work. I don't want to just exist on this earth and take away. Lord, I want my life to be useful. And in the end, I want to hear those words, those important words. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Lord, help us. Help us be faithful. Help us be reliable. Help us be like Timothy and Luke. Lord, just bless this time now as we respond to your word. And I praise you for it all. In Jesus' name, amen. If you'll stand for a few minutes. As they sing, I want to invite you to come.
Wherever
there's anyone needing to be baptized, if you'll make your way over here around the corner. Our baptistry rooms are back there. Be with you shortly. Praise the Lord.
Rachel.
Yes. I'm going to turn you this way here. There we go. Praise the Lord. This is Rachel, and she came forward about a week and a half ago, and trusted the Lord as her personal Lord and Savior. Brother Jeffrey took her back there and showed her, and I told her then about baptism, the importance of that, told her the date, and it's always a blessing when they come, and they right away. It's a good sign. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now, how many people you talk to and lead to the Lord, and you try to explain the importance of following the Lord in baptism? And they kind of dismiss it and say, well, maybe some other time. But when they come, and I think in Granbury, from Granbury, that's pretty amazing. So praise the Lord. I'm excited for her and her new walk with the Lord. I want to ask you to pray with me as we pray for her and Miss Linda. And the Lord has continued to guide them as they walk with Him. So let's pray. Father, thank you so much, Lord. Thank you for the blessings of salvation, Lord, that we can not only have a relationship with you, but walk with you and serve you, Lord. Be a part of the mission that you've given to us. Lord, but this first step of obedience and following you is so important. And Lord, I lift up Rachel, lift up Linda to you. And as these two have committed their lives to you, have accepted your free gift of salvation, Lord, they're now taking this step of obedience and saying they want to follow you. And they're identifying with you publicly. And Lord, we thank you for them. And Lord, we ask you just continue to help them to seek after you with all of their heart. And Lord, help us as a church to guide them and to teach them and to disciple them to follow you all the days of their life. And Lord, just bless this night and may it be special for them and for all of us together, Lord. And we thank you again for this. We ask and pray all of it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Rachel, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in his likeness, and raised to walk in the newness of life. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. All right. Miss Linda. Come on in. Miss Linda, you're from Houston, right?
Not from here. Well, from Chicago.
From Chicago, that's right. I'm Houston. You're wearing a Houston Texan shirt.
Yeah, it was a gift.
She drove all the way from Chicago. No. No, she's gone through our new members class, and in the first week we talk about salvation, we talk about baptism, make sure everybody's on the same page, and we came to that part about baptism, and she said that she was when she was younger. But she knows she didn't understand commitment she had made, and later in life had committed her life to Christ. And before she joined the church, she realized it was important to be obedient, following after him in baptism. And so we're excited. After her baptism, she'll be an official church member, and we'll present her Sunday. And you guys can come by and welcome her to the church. But excited for her. So let's do this. Amen. All right. Let's do the other hand here. There we go. Ms. Linda, I baptize you, my sister. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in his likeness. And raised to walk in the newness of life. Amen. 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 Praise God. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's awesome. I love it. Oh, praise the Lord. Who we got here? Brother Clay, you mind coming dismissing us in prayer? Ladies, don't forget to register for the women's retreat. Please go and do that tonight. I don't want to miss this. Even if you can only come for a Friday night or Saturday, please go online, register, and be a part of that. So, oh, there's no outreach Saturday morning because of the retreat as well. So, yes, sir. Okay, amen. So if you're not sure about the online or you just want to sign up tonight, you can see Rochelle in the back. So, Brother Clay, thank you.
Thank you once again for being here tonight. It's such a blessing to see these new members and new baptism. We just pray that you have a good week and have a blessed time tonight. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you and thank you for this message tonight, Lord, to be faithful, to be true, to be reliable. And I just pray, Lord, that each of us could take it to heart, that we'd be committed to your mission of taking the gospel to the ends of the world, Lord, and to reach in this community that's around us. Bring us souls for our labor, Lord, and bring more laborers into your harvest field. And please bless us tonight. Protect everybody as they travel home. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.